I just want to take a moment to think about how effective the far right is in this country. They're able to impose their minority views on all of American society, all while Democrats are in control of Congress and the White House. But it's still Republicans who are dictating the terms of where we're going to go, the trajectory of this country. And the trajectory is they're trying to drive us straight off of a cliff. Now, it wouldn't be as bad of a situation, even though it's still bad, but it wouldn't be as bad if we had an opposition party that actually was capable and wanted to fight these fascists. But they don't. So when the news broke, Nancy Pelosi on that same day was campaigning for an anti-abortion Democrat. In fact, Democratic Party leadership, Steny Hoyer, Jim Clyburn, Hakeem Jeffries, they all endorsed an anti-abortion Democrat. And this week, as the Supreme Court, as we all learned that they're going to be overturning Roe v. Wade, they're all out campaigning for an anti-abortion Democrat over a progressive. But don't you worry, though, because they vocalized their disapproval. And Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi wrote a strongly worded letter letting everyone know how bad it is that the Supreme Court did this while they campaigned for an anti-abortion Democrat themselves. And while other Democrats didn't endorse this anti-abortion Democrat, they made it very clear that the onus is on voters to fight this. Eric Swalwell writes via Twitter, "There is one and only one way to preserve Roe v. Wade and protect a woman's right to choose, and that's to vote blue in 2022. DCCC Chair Sean Maloney tweeted, "Democrats were angry and hurt, I know, but it's not about filibuster, size of the court, or whatever the Senate hasn't passed. It's about Republicans, not us. We can save our freedoms, but it's November, stupid." In other words, we might have the power currently to do something, but we don't have enough power. So if you don't give us more power when we're basically projected to lose more power, then that's on you. You should have voted harder. Somebody shared the perfect meme underneath Eric Swalwell's tweet. It is a meme of Lucy and Charlie Brown, and Lucy is assuring him, "This is it, Charlie Brown. If you vote one more time, there will be real change." Yeah. See, the problem is that you're expected to lose power in November, not gain power. Now, perhaps Roe v. Wade being overturned will change that. I'm not necessarily sure. To be honest, I'm not thinking about the political implications of this. I'm thinking about the real world harm that this is going to cause on women. I'm not trying to find a way to, you know, have some sort of a political victory over this. But, you know, Democrats, their goal is to get elected, right? But I mean, to do it in this way, it feels so slimy. You're telling us to vote harder. You should fucking fight harder, okay? Now, I can't necessarily say that about members of the House like Eric Swalwell, because the House did its part, but you're still a Democrat who could put pressure on your party's leadership, who's currently stumping for an anti-abortion Democrat. You could reach out, you know, to the president, I'm assuming you have his ear, and tell him, hey, maybe one more time, try fighting Manchin and Sinema. I understand that the situation feels hopeless, but you still just can't do nothing. You still have to fight as the president. Use carrots, use sticks, just show us that there's a sign of life somewhere. But, I mean, the president is definitely not going to do anything, because when he was asked about abolishing the filibuster in order to codify Roe v. Wade, this is what he had to say.
Sir, is the president going to do away with the filibuster to codify Roe?
I'm not prepared to make those judgments now. I think the codification of Roe makes a lot of sense. Look, think what Roe says. Roe says what all basic mainstream religions have historically concluded, that the existence of a human life and being is a question. Is it at the moment of conception? Is it 6 months? Is it 6 weeks? Is it quickening, like Aquinas argued? I mean, so the idea that we're going to make a judgment that is going to say that no one can make the judgment to choose to abort a child based on a decision by the Supreme Court, I think goes way overboard.
Thank you guys.
How fucking inspiring. Rather than assuring the base that he's going to do everything in his power to codify Roe v. Wade by any means necessary, including fighting to get rid of the filibuster, even if that seems like a lost cause, he's saying, I'm not prepared to make those judgments yet. I'm not even sure if I want to have this fight because I might want to keep the filibuster, even if I know what that means for women in this country. Even if that means they go back to back alley coat hanger abortions in 2022, I've got to think about it for a little bit longer. Not sure if I want to fight yet. And yet we're supposed to be excited to get out and vote because you're going to fight for us. You have power now. You have to make use of it. You have to fucking fight. Make do with what you have now, because you will lose power almost certainly in November. So to have this expectation that you're going to gain more power by guilt-tripping voters is ridiculous. Make use of what you got. And if it's not good enough, then you could at least show us that you're going to fight. But you're sitting on your fucking asses and you're doing nothing while fascists ruin this country. How pathetic are Democrats? Joe Biden is conceding before the fight even has begun, and he's the president of the United States. Is there a more feckless and inconsequential president in American history? I can't think of one. Oh, but don't worry. He wants there to be a fight. It's just that he wants you to fight, not him. So President Biden says voters will have to defend fundamental abortion rights in U.S. if Supreme Court scraps guarantees. Oh, really? And how in the fuck do you suppose that we do that, Joe Biden? Back in 2020, voters took to the streets every single day after a racist cop murdered George Floyd. In fact, that movement catalyzed a global Black Lives Matter movement. And do you want to know what happened? Nothing. Nothing happened after that. So what are we supposed to do? Well, the one thing that we can do is vote harder. Okay. Then what? Are you going to fight if we give you 3 more senators? Well, we don't have 60. Okay, if we give you 61 senators, well, 2 of them, they don't agree with us. So, I mean, there's never going to be enough senators, enough Democrats in Congress for them to actually fight, because they don't want to fight. They've demonstrated this time and time again. They surrender immediately because they just don't give a fuck. They don't care. Now, I know what people are going to say. Look, they tried fighting. They tried passing voting rights. They tried passing Build Back Better, but Manchin and Sinema, they just won't budge. The problem is that there's always going to be some corporate Democrat who's the scapegoat, right? If it's not Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema, it'll be John Tester and some other dickhead. Before, it was Joe Lieberman. There's always going to be a villain who Democrats will blame for their incompetence. But even if it's the case that nothing you do will get Joe Manchin and Sinema to budge, which I don't believe, by the way, but even if there's nothing you can do, you have to at least exhaust all options and try everything. And Democrats have conceded before the fight even begins. Before he even talks to Manchin and Sinema, presumably he's saying, I don't even know if I want to get rid of the filibuster for this. It's just not important to me. They never fight. They always back down. And this isn't a new phenomenon. This is what Democrats have always done. For example, take a look at the way that Obama responded to Roe v. Wade before and after he got elected.
What would you do at the federal level, not only to ensure access to abortion, but to make sure that the judicial nominees that you will inevitably be able to pick are true to the core tenets of Roe v. Wade?
Well, the first thing I'd do as president is sign the Freedom of Choice Act. That's the first thing that I'd do. Now, the Freedom of Choice Act is not my highest legislative priority. I believe that women should have the right to choose, but I think that the most important thing we can do to tamp down some of the anger surrounding this issue is to focus on those areas that we can agree on, and that's where I'm going to focus.
Yeah, see, now back then, do you want to know what the story was? It wasn't that Obama just decided to give up on codifying Roe v. Wade. The story was, well, we might have a filibuster-proof Senate majority, but the problem is Joe Lieberman, he just won't budge. We have 59 votes, and we need 60 votes. So, you should have voted harder. Fuck any Democrat who is in power currently and shifts the responsibility on to voters. You have power. We don't. Fight now. Work with what you've got. Don't expect voters to deliver you a bigger majority because you can't accomplish shit that you need to accomplish because you refuse to fight. You have to fight right now if you expect voters to elect more Democrats, because if they see that you're doing fuck all, they're not going to vote harder for you. Do you understand that? Do you understand that this is why people hate Democrats, including their own base? because this is what you do. It's not like Democrats don't know how to fight, because they know how to fight progressives and leftist candidates very fucking well. It's just that they choose to not fight when it's convenient. They choose to back down from fights against Republicans because, you know, this isn't necessarily something that they care about from a policy standpoint. They just want to fundraise off of it and use it as some sort of a cudgel to beat voters with. Well, fuck that. Fuck any Democrat who does this. It's unacceptable. Stop letting them use this excuse. Stop all of the bullshit excuses. They're not fighting right now and they're in power. Again, even if you fight and you fail, at least you can tell us that you tried, but they're not even fucking trying. And they're just saying, I'm not going to do anything. You have to do something. Voters have to fight. How do we do that? How the fuck do we do that? There's more voter suppression now than there was in 2020. And you expect more people to come out and vote? Their logic makes no sense. The reason why Republicans are ruining this country is because they know Democrats aren't going to do a single fucking thing about this. Why? Because Democrats are insulated from all of the bad things that Republicans are doing. All of these rich Democrats in Congress, you know, they're not going to lose access to abortion. They could just go to a blue state. They can go to a different country if they need an abortion. They're not going to lose health care. They don't have to be bogged down by student debt for the rest of their lives. So they don't give a fuck. They're insulated from all of the cruel things that the GOP does to us. So they just sit there and they, keep that seat warm until Republicans inevitably take it over. It's truly a horrible death spiral that we're locked into where, you know, Americans are so fed up with Republicans that they vote for Democrats, and then Democrats do nothing, so they don't turn out to vote. Republicans take over again, and then, you know, Democrats win again after we're reminded of how terrible the Republicans are. Like, how do we break this cycle? I don't know that we can break this cycle. I think that we're just going to continue to spiral until climate change engulfs all of us in flames. Like, it's a sad state of reality, but I mean, it's fucking true at this point. There's no hope, and Democrats are so weak and pathetic that they have backed down every single time, and they still put the onus on voters. What a pathetic excuse for a political party. Holy shit.